The scientific method is essentially a guideline for how science is done. And although what I'll be presenting sounds like a series of steps, typically it is not as linear or as straightforward as this presentation is going to lead you to believe. But we have to start somewhere. And so where we're going to begin is with the hypothesis. Now, sometimes you will hear a hypothesis described as an educated guess. That really isn't a good definition of a hypothesis, because a hypothesis, first and foremost, must be testable. And if you're just guessing about something, that may or may not be testable. So for science, we need a way of testing our hypothesis. As an example, I propose that if I were to look at other stars, here's my star, that I hypothesize that around that star, I'm going to find planets orbiting it. Now, that in and of itself can count as a hypothesis, but I need to specify how would I test this. And that's where the prediction comes in. This is going to be how the hypothesis is tested. If I can't predict anything, I am not dealing with a hypothesis. If I can't test anything, I am not dealing with a hypothesis. So my hypothesis, I'm going to predict, I'm going to take pictures of my star, and on my pictures, I'm going to expect to see planets. So this is how I'm going to test the hypothesis. I'm going to go out, I'm going to take some nice pictures, and look to see if I find any planets. So that's my first step. Now my next step then is to actually test the hypothesis. And that's my experiment. Now in astronomy, when we think of experiments, we usually think of something in a laboratory. Not a lot of astronomy can take place in a laboratory. So astronomers do a lot of their experiments either in an observatory, where we do an observation, or we make computer models, which aren't nearly as sexy sounding as going out to an observatory, but actually probably about 80% of astronomy is done at a computer, creating models using the known laws of physics and seeing how those laws apply in different situations. Now, my particular hypothesis that there are planets around other stars that I'm going to be able to take pictures and see those planets, that I can do in an observatory. So I'm testing the hypothesis to see if my prediction comes true. Because that's very powerful. Making a prediction on a brand new idea and seeing if that actually comes true or not. So I go out, I take pictures of stars, and I develop my pictures, and I look at them, and I see a nice field of stars, and I don't see a single planet. And the reason why I won't see a planet is because stars are very, very bright and very, very big. Planets are very, very small and very, very faint. And so if you have something very tiny and very faint next to something very big and very bright, and you take a picture, you're not going to see the tiny, faint thing under most circumstances. So I am sad to report that my prediction did not come true. And so I need to go to my next step. So because my prediction didn't come true, I am going to modify. Now I have a choice. I could either modify the hypothesis, or I could modify the experiment, or I could completely throw out my original idea. So in this case, I'm going to modify. Now I think my hypothesis was correct, but I think my experiment was flawed. So because my predictions did not come true, I did not get pictures of planets, I'm going to try something different. In our own solar system, here's our sun. And for simplicity's sake, we're going to pick just one planet. In this case, I'm going to pick Jupiter, because Jupiter is the biggest. I will emphasize that that is not drawn to scale. Now, we think of the solar system as being the sun sitting still and the planets orbiting around the sun. But the fact of the matter is, although the sun is big, and it certainly is going to dominate all the gravity that takes place, the planets exert a gravitational pull on the sun. So the sun is pulling on Jupiter. Jupiter is also pulling on the sun. So the sun is going to move in reaction to that and is going to follow a very small orbital path. Now, I've very vastly exaggerated that drawing. In reality, it's going to be more like the sun is in one spot, and kind of, if this is the center of the sun, the center of the sun does a little wiggle in place. So the sun is going to be kind of wobbling back and forth in place. Now, visually, that would be difficult to see. But astronomers have a technique that allows us to measure motion. It's called Doppler shift. You can see another tutorial if you want to learn about that. But the idea is we can measure when things are moving. So I'm going to, instead of looking to actually take a picture, I'm going to look to measure the motion of my star and see if that works. And it turns out that yes, that does work. And using that technique, I think it's close to 2,000 planets around other stars have been discovered. So my experiment just worked. So you would think, okay, you're done. But I'm not. There's one more step. So the last thing we need to do before we are certain that we are right is called peer review. And the idea of peer review is basically make sure others get the same results. Because I could have done something wrong. And in fact, one of the first announcements of a planet going around another star turned out they didn't take into account the fact that here on planet Earth, we are moving in orbit around the sun. So when we measure motions, we need to subtract our own motion. They forgot to do that. So the motion that they thought they were measuring of the star moving back and forth was actually Earth moving back and forth. So in a sense, yes, they did discover a planet, but the planet they discovered was Earth. So peer review is a way of catching things like that. You want them to test it to make sure they get the same results. They want to look for any mistakes you might have made. My results, my peers did the same thing. They got the same results. We're looking good. So our last stage, kind of our goal with any idea in science, is to become an accepted theory. And in order for something to be an accepted theory, it needs to repeatedly be confirmed by experiment. Now, my planet example is fairly straightforward. Either there are planets or not. It's now widely accepted that yes, there are planets around other stars because we have found so many and the results consistently are confirmed. But this word theory in day-to-day language is very different from how we use the word theory in science. You'll hear people say, oh, that's just a theory. Well, in science, just a theory is kind of an oxymoron, because a theory has gone through all of this to get to that point. So we put a big don't do this red bar through that. If you want to say something along those lines, what you really should say, that's just a hypothesis, because that is your initial idea before it has been tested. Now, if it's not even testable, then I recommend saying that's just nuts. So a theory is a very powerful thing. You don't want to dismiss something that's called a theory. Gravity is a theory. Now, we don't say it's been proven, so we can't use that word, because often you're dealing with ideas that are so broad we can't prove the whole realm of what it covers. Relativity comes to mind. The theory of relativity is very broad, and it is still being tested. There are two theories that are very controversial, evolution and the Big Bang. Both of them have been repeatedly confirmed by experiment. That's why they are called theories. They are very broad. We can never say that either has been proven. But what we can say is observational evidence consistently upholds it. So when we look at all the observational evidence, it is consistently upholding the idea of evolution. Observational evidence consistently upholds the idea of the Big Bang. Observational evidence consistently upholds the theory of relativity. Observational evidence consistently upholds the theory of gravity. All of those theories have repeatedly been tested and confirmed. So that's our scientific method. Now, even accepted theories can be thrown out when we find something that contradicts it. For close to 2,000 years, we believed Earth was the center of the universe. It wasn't until the invention of the telescope that we found that that was in fact incorrect. So there was an accepted theory. There were models in place that made predictions that were consistently confirmed, and yet it was wrong. So science is being brave enough to say, I was wrong, and I need to change my ideas. And that's a key element to the scientific method, admitting when something no longer works and changing to new ideas. And that's why the scientific method is so powerful, because it provides that framework that incorporates into it the whole idea of modifying and throwing out ideas that don't work. That's how science works.